Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Economy and Function Principles presentation, Jesus briefly summarizes God's principles of economy and function that govern the operation of God's laws, gives examples of the way these principles are built into God's laws, and answers audience questions about the principles. Recorded on the 5th of November 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Well, we come to the last couple of discussions of the day. As I said, this will be our most complicated day because we've gone through six principles in one day. Whereas the rest of the time, the maximum I think we're going through is three principles in a day. So it's going to be a bit of a complicated day this day. And unfortunately, as you can see, we're just skimming over it, aren't we? Skimming over the top of it. Obviously, you can see every time you ask a question, it goes, oh, wow, I could ask that question too and that question too. And then before you know it, you can see how easily we could chew up a month of time asking all these different questions about each principle and how they operate in different areas. You can also see from my discussion about the human soul, for example, that things are a bit more complicated than probably what you've thought in the past. And obviously that makes sense considering that the human soul is the most complex of all creations. All right, well, we've now come to the economy and function principles. I notice you have a bit of trouble with this principle, huh? Both of these principles. And yeah, there's a lot of confronting emotions in these principles that God employs in all of God's creation. And it's very important, I feel, that you start to understand them because you'll actually stop doing a lot of things that you currently do if you really understand these principles, and you'll start doing a lot of things that you've never done as a result of understanding them as well. So let's start with the economy principles. Let's look at the summary related to the economy principles. So economy principles ensure that each creation and law economically uses resources by ensuring, and the very first thing is very important, the equal value of resources. And resources, by resources, we mean the equal value of time, matter, and energy as resources that we can use to create, or God uses to create. And God views each of these things as having an equal value. So he doesn't waste time just to save matter. And he doesn't save matter just to save time. And he doesn't spend energy that creates nothing. Which often you do all three of those things in your life, right? So we need to see, if we truly understood this principle from an aspect of love and from a soul perspective, we would cease doing a lot of things that are a waste of time, and we would start doing things that actually are going to benefit the rest of our existence as our highest priority. God also ensures the economical creation of function. And we'll define function in the function principles, so we'll get to that a bit later. But the economy principles ensure that the best allocation of time, matter, and energy, in other words, the best allocation of resources, are used to create function. And function is never a single function, right, with God. There's just multiple functions. Even the very smallest of particles have multiple functions. And this is a very important thing that God has designed into the universe. And in some cases, in fact, in your case, the highest of God's creations, there are literally billions of possible functions that God's designed inside of the soul, most of which I believe we've yet to discover, even in the person in the highest condition has yet to discover. So this allows for the automation of laws and creations with no external maintenance. Now, why that's very important to economy, because if you've got to maintain something from an external thing, you can see it's a lot harder, isn't it? It's like having a garden. You imagine if you just, if you could just go and your garden's there and you didn't have to water it, you didn't have to, you know, look after it, you didn't have to do anything to it, it just all was automatically maintaining, that would be a lot better, wouldn't it, than you having to go out each day, spend a few hours here and a few hours there. Do you see the difference? What God creates, everything's automated. And there are many functions that are very intrinsic to your survival that God has already automated. Breathing is one of them. You don't go and that being a conscious choice that you're having to make to breathe, do you? Right? The choice to breathe is instinctual, built into the creation. It needs to breathe, it wants to breathe, and it breathes. Does that make sense? It's not something that some external thing has got to dictate, because the internal law dictates that breath is required for life, in the case of a human body in particular. So this is an example of automation of laws and creations as an economy principle, because it's economical to put those things inside of the creation rather than having to have some kind of external thing that does it, you know. Economy is incorporated within each creation and law. So it's not only the creations that have economy principles incorporated, but the laws themselves also have economy principles. So in other words, God never makes a law that is superfluous. And remember earlier, Deidre asked a question about, you know, cockroaches. God never makes a creation that's superfluous either. And that's a part of the economy. God doesn't do things that are superfluous. There's always a role. Each thing God creates has function, and as a result is the most economical way to create that function. Very clever. Very clever. Now, there are quite a few little confronting issues in this area of economy, and that is that, there's things that it demonstrates that we are doing as a human race that God wouldn't do, right? So we need to examine those things, to be honest, because they are wasting a lot of your life. A lot of your life is getting wasted because you're not being economical the way God is economical, right? And we'll talk about that when we come to some of your questions, hopefully. Some of your questions, there's a few questions that are interesting, so we'll discuss some of that. So with gravity, economical. One law benefits everything that is alive on the planet. That's economy, isn't it? One thing benefits everything. Yeah, just a simple example of economy. So God doesn't go, oh, because that's an ant, I'm going to make it different for that. And because that's a bird, I'm going to make it different for that. And because that's a human, I'll make it different for that. None of that. It all is just one law, applied the same way, right across the board, affecting each one of those creations, benefiting each one of those creations. Aerodynamics. Knowing the higher law results in more economical use of time, energy, and resources to accomplish larger outcomes. Right? If we really designed the craft properly on the planet, we would even design it so it didn't need a takeoff, didn't need a landing, that it could take off straight up and land straight down, and that it was in complete harmony with all the laws of involving, you know, think destruction of the environment and all these other issues, and on top of that could carry loads. And on top of that, could move from place to place. And that would mean we wouldn't need roads at all. Imagine that. All of a sudden, we've gotten rid of a lot of destruction that automatically is occurring on the planet. Don't need roads anymore. And we could make it so it's safe, so that it automatically determines the ability, the proximity to living organisms and other things. And it automatically compensates for those particular things. And then on top of that, it can transport us. That'd be great, wouldn't it? Right? And it's a matter of just finding out the laws that would allow us to redesign our vehicle. And that vehicle would, you'd see, you could replace a truck, a semi-trailer, a tractor, a car, a plane, an aeroplane, and a helicopter, and a number of other things, all with one device, right, as well. That's economy, isn't it? Making one device does everything. At the moment, we, you know, have all these different types of vehicles for different functions. We could just have one vehicle for all functions, if we designed it cleverly enough. That's what God does. Yeah. Okay. Automation. Very important part of economy, as I said. Instinct built into each living creature and default operation built into all matter. So an example we've given there is breathing, you know, where all living organisms that are, you know, that are mammals generally need to breathe. So we need air, oxygen to survive. And as a result of that, it's an automatic function. It's not something with the brain. You have to remind yourself to tell yourself to breathe. Imagine if you did. It'd be just another job you'd have to think about, isn't it? And imagine if God didn't automate all the functions in your body, you'd have to tell yourself to do this, tell yourself to that. And there's over a billion functions in your body. So imagine by the time you got around to this, working out which one was stable and which one wasn't and how to fix it, you'd be back at the beginning, well and truly, and you'd have no time for anything else. You wouldn't have time to think about anything else. You wouldn't have time to feel about anything else. You wouldn't have time to enjoy your life. You wouldn't have time to make love or to be happy or to be content or go swimming or anything. You know, you'd have no time. It's all just maintain my functions, wouldn't it? And so God's made a lot of these things automatic so that you don't have to worry about all that. That's great, huh? Most complex being in the universe, and you don't have to worry about most of it. And the trouble is we don't worry about hardly any of it. That's a problem, but we need to fix that. But okay, look at decomposition. It's very simple, but again, you can see the economy of it. Decomposition allows for fertile ground, sustains more life, food for insects, birds, other living creatures. It allows for elements, the degradation and the re-establishment of elements in the system so that they can be used for other things. And even just the falling tree creates light so other things can grow and so forth. It's just like there's so many systems that are all supported by the one thing. Like if you had to list just what a tree can do, you'd be going for pages and pages and pages and pages of functions besides looking beautiful and besides feeling good when you're under one, right? Just amazing functions. Very, very clever with economy, God is, allowing all these functions to be the best possible use of time, energy and matter to create and to sustain life. Yeah. Very powerful. So, what do we see about them? Basically, they ensure all laws and creations economically use and treat of equal value the resources of time, energy, and matter, and ensure that no resource is wasted and that abundance exists naturally within the universe. Now, this is very interesting. See, most of us see economy as an inverse function of abundance. But actually, the way God creates economy means there is abundance. Means there's an excess of everything. Does that make sense? Very clever. You see, and this shows us that we have some very serious problems as humanity with regard to this principle. And what drives our economy? Fear drives your economy. Fear. You're worried that you won't have enough. That's the main thing that drives your economy. And I mean not just your economy in terms of financial economy, I mean your very life. Most of your life is dictated to by this fear that you're not going to have enough and you need more and you need more and you need more. And have you found that enough is enough ever? Usually not, right? You need more. And you get used to a certain level. You notice that? So, you know, when I was much younger, and what I noticed was quite often I had no money. When I say no money, I mean $0 in a bank account. And that was what I had. And there was still food to put on the table and so forth. And what I found was when I had $10,000 in the bank, I started getting used to $10,000 being in the bank. Have you noticed that? And then you think that's not enough. And so you just start adding zeros as to what's enough. But actually, zero was enough. I still lived and survived and still enjoyed myself. So that was enough. Interesting how we often have this fear-based concept of economy. God does not have a fear-based concept of economy. To God, economy is all about ethics and morality. Do you understand that, what I just said? It's all about ethics and morality. It's what is right to do, not what is fear-based or what is driven by fear to do. Why is it right to economically use resources? Well, if you think about it, it makes sense, doesn't it? If you economically use resources, you create an outcome that is available with the least amount of input of time, energy, and matter. Isn't that the loving thing to do? Isn't that the ethical thing to do? Of course it is. That's why God does it. So actually, one of the reasons why God has engaged this particular principle is because of ethics. It's a principle of not using any more than you need to use in order to create something of benefit. Anyway, what do we do? Well, we do a lot of things, don't we? It's just like, and we could, with these examples, by the way, Mary and I were going through and she said, oh, add that one, add that one, add that one, add that one. And we could have come up with like hundreds of pages of them, you know. But we had to stop somewhere, so we tried to stop at a page. But as you see later on, it goes over in the two pages with most of them. But we place financial matters ahead of time, matter, and energy. You guys doing that all the time, are you not? You even did it coming here for most of you. You go, what's the cheapest way I could get there? Oh, getting up at 4 a.m. in the morning. That's the best flight. That's called the red eye, right? So what I do is I take the red eye because it's $1,000 cheaper or whatever, $500 cheaper. Why did I do that? Because I don't have abundance. I don't believe in it. I don't create abundance. And primarily it's because I don't love myself enough, actually. I don't love myself enough to get up at a reasonable hour. Mind you, here in Queensland at the moment, 4 o'clock's daylight. But I mean, if you're in a country where it's dark or whatever. Creating without consideration for future resource usage. I see a lot of you doing that with your gardens. You create a lovely garden, not realizing that you're going to have to use a lot of time and a lot of water to maintain it. So you're creating without consideration of future resource usage. God doesn't do that. He always knows what's going to happen with regard to future resources. Right? I see it a lot when you go driving down the road, you know, when they're fixing up roads. You're there sitting at a stoplight for maybe sometimes 15 minutes waiting for traffic coming past and going. You're sitting there. Many times people are there with their cars running, engines running, while this work's getting done. Now, why is the work getting done when there's a high amount of traffic? That doesn't make much sense, does it? It's like, basically what we're doing is we're not considering the total resource usage. We're not seeing all those fuel, all those cars, all those noxious fumes, all the time of the and of the people sitting there in the line. You imagine there's 100 vehicles with 2 people in each vehicle. It's 200 people. 200 people sitting there for 15 minutes is how many hours? That's a lot, right? 50 hours. That's like one person's wage in 15 minutes being wasted. Bang. Every 15 minutes. Now that's in a small environment. Just put that in a city where there's thousands of cars waiting. Now you've got hours and hours and hours and hours of time being wasted. But we don't consider it. You know why? Because it's somebody else's time. We don't value our time and somebody else's time as the same value. We don't. Why don't we? Because we're very selfish and we believe our time is worth more than anybody else's time. So if I can save my time only to make you spend five times the amount of time, I'll do it. Right? Not considering the lack of love, the lack of respect, the lack of honor, the lack of resource management, the lack of economy. You see, we do this all the time. It's just like constantly, selfishly valuing personal resources over the resources of others. You do that with money. I see you do that with money all the time. As long as you've got some, everything's fine, right? What about if somebody else doesn't? That doesn't matter. What if those somebody else's have had years and years and years of us taking from them and they still don't and they feel pretty angry about it? Well, now we go to war with them to keep them under control, right? We're willing to sacrifice their life for that one thing. Because we selfishly value our own resources over the resources of others. Willing to go to war for it, murder for it, kill for it. So there we go. There's that economy principles. Can you see bringing your life into harmony with economy principles? Wow, there's a few things you're going to have to change there. Give up that nice, pretty garden and really see what you can create if you truly use your resources properly. You might finish up with a prettier garden in the long run, right? But you don't believe that because you want instant results, right? We're also not patient. We want instant results. When we go, I'm going to work my guts out. I'll even be half dead as long as I get this done. Right. Once I got it done, I'll feel good about what I've done. And then as soon as you've created it, for the majority of us, as soon as we've created it, God's trying to destroy it. Bang, bang, bang. All the laws are trying to knock it back into what it should be because of the fact that we're not in harmony with economy principles, not in harmony with function principles, not in harmony with love principles, not in harmony with all these principles. God's laws are already trying to destroy what we've created. And that's why very little of what humans create lasts any longer than the human themselves lasts. It's true, isn't it? You know, it's pretty unusual to see a house that's lasted 1,000 years. Pretty unusual. Some clever person come up with that idea. All right, so now let's have a look at function principles, shall we? Let's look at our summary. Function principles ensure that each creation and law has many functional purposes. And in fact, as I said, like for a tree, has like such a large list of functional purposes that we have yet to even discover some of the functional purposes. That's how many it has. It's just like an incredible list. What does it do? It treats of equal value the outcomes of results, beauty and the use of resources. And remember, we used the term resources for time, energy and matter. So it treats of equal value the outcomes that are resulting from those inputs, if you like. And it sees results, beauty and the use of resources as outcomes as well as what eventually gets created. So when I say as outcomes, it sees the economical use of resource as an outcome, right, as well. Okay? Some of you have asked interesting questions about that. Multiple functions are automatically fulfilled. God, as far as I'm aware, because I've done a lot of investigation of this subject, God has never created something with a single function that I've ever seen. Interesting. From the smallest particle right to, in fact, the smallest particles have the largest amount of functions because they're used in the majority of things. Even to the largest thing, they never have a single function. Multiple functions. And when we say multiple, in some cases, it's like thousands or tens of thousands, sometimes even millions of functions created through one creation. So it's economical multifunctionality. Yeah. It's an amazing, amazing thing that God's done there. And it's the automation of function and outcome. So remember, it treats of equal value all outcomes, and it automates the outcomes even. And so we get an automation process occurring where, and economy dictates automation in function. Is that a bit hard for you to grasp? Economy dictates automation in function. In other words, if I'm truly economical with what I create, it will automatically have multi-functions, and those functions will be automated. So that I don't have to do anything. Don't have to work for it, right? It all happens naturally. Yeah. You can see there's a bit of a problem with gardens, right? instinctive desire to fulfill all outcomes. Now, each creation has an instinctive, you could call it an instinctive, but for many of these creations, it's matter only. It's not actually the living creature. So it's actually a property of the matter that it fulfills the outcome. So you could say, like, a property of hydrogen and a property of oxygen is that it has a large attraction to each other. So it has a desire, if you like, but it's really just a inbuilt property that causes it to amalgamate to create a life-giving substance to all creatures. Does that make sense? God created that automatic instinctive desire or automatic function so that other things could survive and exist. Yeah, goodness me, clever, eh? Clever, clever. All very clever. Let's have a look at the examples again. Gravity. Gravity does lots of different things. And in fact, gravity itself is the result of myriads of, like, thousands of laws all combining into one. Right? To create gravity itself. And gravity itself then sustains atmosphere, it sustains life, it sustains, it keeps us on the planet, in an atmospheric environment that sustains life. It does so many different things. It keeps us safe, it keeps us secure, it allows us to live within the boundaries of the human body's condition of growth and so forth. It does all these different things. Just one law, which is not really one law even. It's thousands of laws combining. Aerodynamics, very similar. Now, interesting thing with aerodynamics, while only recently enjoyed, and here I'm talking about flight, while only recently enjoyed by the human itself, birds and other creatures have engaged flight that benefits and inspires humans. Now, even a fly, like, the humble fly, he benefits you. In fact, without the fly, you'd be waist deep in waste. Because the fly produces a large amount of larvae, which allows it to get rid of a large amount of things in a very short period of time. Multiply that by how many flies there are on the planet, and you get a huge garbage munching machine. That's what you get. All with the instinct to make it better, to make the whole process better. And not only that, when they run out of garbage, they automatically shut themselves down and pupate and just sit there waiting for the next garbage. Right? So if there's no garbage, they don't reproduce as fast and they don't do everything as fast as they would normally do. But they just keep themselves surviving and even can last. Many of the garbage munching machines that we have on the planet, of which insects primarily are, can last sometimes even tens or even hundreds of years in a state of suspended animation, waiting for the next event. That's why all of a sudden there's a big event, bang, they're there, within a few days, off doing their garbage munching machine duties, inbuilt in the creation, function in creation. Amazing, amazing creation, really. Very clever. Okay, how about trees? Well, we've talked about trees a lot, but geez, if you start trying to list all of the things that a tree or a plant actually does, you'd be going for days, honestly. It's just like one after the other after the other. And then to understand all of those things that it does, well, mankind still doesn't even understand most of it. Like, we talk about photosynthesis, but have any of us created a thing that actually can photosynthesize at this point? Not yet, right? So it's very interesting that we can't even replicate, even given the level of our current technology, we can't even replicate the most basic of functions in one of God's creations. And then we tell ourselves that it all evolved and we can't even replicate it through creation. But it just amazes me that we still think that everything just came about naturally somehow without there being a lot of laws and other things designed that allows all these things to come into existence. Every human-specific law has multiple functions. Removing sin, transformation, making you smell, look, and feel good. And literally that's true, you know, like smell good as well as you develop and grow. Like, you go up to people in the spirit world in the celestial kingdom, you get smell under their armpit. I don't know why some of you get challenged like that, but anyway, and it automatically smells good, like a beautiful rose or whatever aroma, depending on the personality of the individual. Not that they go around doing that every day, of course, but it's just the truth. So function principles ensure all laws and creations have multiple functional purposes for their creation and existence, and treat all of equal value all the resources of time, energy and matter, and all the outcomes, including function and beauty. Right? So God never creates something that's beautiful that isn't also functional. And God never creates something that's functional that isn't also beautiful. Right? Function principles ensure that each creation has multiple purposes and that each purpose benefits other creations. And you could say all other creations, actually. Very clever system. Very clever system. Now, what do? We don't value resources of time, energy and matter and the obtained results and beauty equally. We don't. If something's beautiful, I've seen many of you create something that's just beautiful and has no other purpose than to look at it, and you think it's fantastic. You know what happens in our household when that happens? Where do you think it goes? In the bin. Well, usually in a landfill so that some animals and creatures can benefit from its degradation. That's where it goes. Because just something to look at is not really something that's actually based on function, right? It's got to produce something. Even if it's just an emotion in you, it's better than producing nothing. Creating without a function, creating with a single function, destroying the environment to create, creating products that cover over the truth. Interesting, we do that a lot, don't we? Yeah. So we have an epidemic of insects, and instead of looking at the reason why we have one, we go and spray them all. Isn't that creating a product that covers over the truth? Same as the makeup for women, right? So if you want to play with makeup and you're using it to muck around, well, that's a different thing than if you're just using it to cover over yourself, to cover over your condition. If you're covering over, just using it to cover over your condition, then all you're doing is covering over truth. And is that in harmony with any of these principles? Probably not, right? Why are you doing that? Because you don't want to see reflected in the mirror the reflection of your own condition. But God's created all of God's laws to help you see your own condition so that you can do something about it. Okay, so function principles, there they are. Amazing principles, huh? These principles, really? Again, these, remember, with all of these principles, they are aspects of love. So when we talk about economy and the way God sees economy, it's an aspect of love from God's perspective. It's an actual thing we'll learn about love by discussing the economy details. And function is about love, actually. The reason why God's created these principles is because of love and truth, of course. truth is great with function, obviously. Good, eh? Yeah. Like, can you imagine if we discussed every principle? It'd be like, we'd be here going, I just love it. It's so fascinating. Yeah. Actually, sorry about that. So what we're going to do now is just have a Q&A on the subject. I noticed some of you have left some questions here, but there seems to be quite a shortage of questions on this subject, and most of the questions seem to be related to different emotions you're having about the subject now, rather than being a bit more expansive, but we'll cover some of them, some of the questions. We'll need just a minute for us to transfer over to the discussion. So this presentation is all to do with economy and function principles Q&A. So the first Q&A we'll do is with regard to economy principles. And what we'll do is we'll start with Jane. Jane. If we can start with your economy question, not your first economy question.
So the second one, okay. How is economy...
That's the second one I've got in this list. Let's do the first one.
If God feels that time, matter and energy are equally valued, then why is there this pressure about time, like this pressure of time, more so than anything else?
Yeah, good question, huh? Yeah. It's a really simple answer. Because humans made it so. How have we made it so? Well, what we've done is we firstly are... As you've seen from our soul discussion in a previous example with life principles, what we've done is we're restricting our life by restricting the amount of time we have in our life, particularly in a physical sense, by restricting their longevity. And why? How are we restricting our longevity? By restricting our emotions, we finish up restricting our longevity. And here I'm talking about when we have a whole set of emotions that are out of harmony with truth and love, we are now restricting our longevity. As a subsequent result of restricting of our longevity, we automatically have less time.
And it's also because of we're so afraid of death and we think the physical life is just the only life.
Correct. As a result of having less time and believing this falsity that we believe, which is that there is no such thing as a future life, we now feel that we're restricted to creating within 70 or 80 years. But the only trouble with the 70 or 80 or 90 years is the last 20 are not too comfortable. So what we've got to do is try to get them in 60 or 50 years. Does that make sense? And then we found that the first 20 we pretty much wasted, right? So now what we've got is from 20 years to 50 years. So really now we've only got 30 years to create. And so most of us in that 30-year period, we want to have children. We want to have a house. We want to have cars. We want to have security. We want to create. And so can you see all the pressure it places on us? Of course it places huge amounts of pressure on us, but it's all pressure we created.
It's like we put it on ourselves.
We have to put it on ourselves. It's all pressure we created. So it's our responsibility for that creation. The reason why we have no time is because we created a life where there is barely any time. It's got nothing to do with what God created. God created your physical body to live thousands of years. Do you think you'd be worried about having children? You know, you'd get around to about 300 or 400 and say, maybe I should have some kids now, maybe, you know, like, I've learned enough now to see what not to do and what to do, so now I'll have some, you know what I mean? And then you get to about 800 or 900, you go, oh, maybe I should have a house, you know, I've been nomadic now for a while, just a few hundred years, and maybe I should have a house and we can, you know, maybe you should have a place to stay. And then you go, well, I don't want a place to stay. I've spent 800 years without one, and it doesn't make much sense. Can you see we'd also, use more less resources as a result, because we're not in this panic to get in order to have an experience that we're just restricting all the time. And then on top of that, we'd have a lot more free emotional experiences. So we'd have time to think and time to feel and time to analyze and contemplate and to examine things, rather than being in such a panic that we do, and we've got no time left for anything of any major importance, right? And so you imagine if you had a few thousand years on Earth, By the time you got to a couple of thousand, you might say, oh, I've seen most places now, and I've lived around, and most of my friends are moving on to the spirit world now. And, you know, they're all left a few thousand years. You've got to know a fair few of them, obviously. And now you can move on yourself if you want to, but that might be a choice rather than a forced situation because of your emotional restrictions that you're placing on the recovery of your physical body. That makes sense? So this is our problem, is we're often judging many things through the restricted viewpoint we have that we created. We created the very restrictions that we're now viewing things through.
Yeah, and so I often thought about it, well, like with time, so God created night and day, but we created time, is that?
Well, no, God created night and day because at night we go to sleep and it's a recovery of your physical body, and then you get to spend all of your time in your sleep state to experience life there. So the one reason why God created it that way was so that you would learn about your next life before you leave this one. So, of course, that makes sense, doesn't it? Like, why would God just go, no, I'm not going to let you sleep. You're going to have to stay awake the whole time. You know, what's that saying? You know, I'll sleep when I'm dead or whatever. And so that's the way God created everything. I'll sleep when I'm dead. But the problem is that I'd receive no education about my next life. And if I don't receive any education about my next life, is that very loving? Not very, is it? It's like all of a sudden uprooting a person after living here a few thousand years, shoving them in a new life, and they've got no idea where they are anymore, and no idea what's happening, no idea what's going to happen, and no idea how to control things, no idea how to do anything. That wouldn't be very loving, would it? So God created your sleep state that allows you to go to sleep, rest this body, experience things in your sleep state experience that you can learn about your life in the spirit world, so that when you do make that transition, you're home and hosed. You reach a point of recollection, you go, now I know where I am, and I've been here every day since I was born. Right? Isn't that wonderful? What a loving... But that's a part of God's economic creation too. He's educating you the most economical way by actually making one third of your life what is going to be your new life after you've passed. Yeah, lovely. You got to admire him, eh? He's so lovable. Now, economy principles, that was Deidre, and we're at Jane.
Could you please explain further? God does not waste emotional and spiritual experiences.
All right, so let's define emotional experience. What is a spiritual experience? What is a spiritual experience? S-P-I-R. What's that? It's an experience of, related to, love. Somebody said it. I think it was Dave over here, wasn't it? It was. Good on you, man. So spiritual experience is a love-based experience, right? So you know how all these people go, well, they're New Agey stuff and it's all metaphysical, or you have all the people who are involved in a religion and it's spiritual is like, you know, praying five times a day or whatever it is that their regime or different process is, going to meetings or whatever else. Well, that to God is not spiritual. Right. Spiritual is anything to do with love. That's spiritual from God's perspective. So let's look at that. We've got spiritual experiences and then we've got emotional experiences. Now, obviously, love is an emotional experience as well, isn't it? Because love is an emotion. But emotional experiences are energy flowing through your soul, which then affect your spirit, physical body, isn't it? Emotional is energy in motion. Huh? When I say God does not waste it, it means that every single thing that God has done has not only been to create function and beauty and all these other outcomes, but one of the major outcomes is so that you benefit spiritually and that you benefit emotionally. So every single experience is not just a single experience to create some kind of, you know, process mathematically, but it's also so that you can start to enjoy some spiritual and emotional experiences, which are a part of the function that God creates. So if we examine economy, he's basically saying part of economy is me creating for you. So this is God talking to you, he's saying, me creating for you this concept of love and energy and motion, emotions being a part of what I wanted to create for you. See, we dismiss this and we go, no, we just want to get our house made and we just want to get this done and we want to get that done. We don't see actually it's the experience of doing these things that is the actual thing that brings us joy. And God knows that is the case, and so that's why he's developed it this way. So for God, to God, energy, remember, energy, of which these things are they not, are an important part of the economic process. So he wants to create them for you. Yeah. Yep. Mary, you wanted to ask?
Actually, I wanted to say.
You want to say it?
I wanted to.
Okay, say it.
No. Was just to add, we can also see that every attraction that we have in our life, even if it's something that's, sorry, corny.
Why don't you come at the front and say? So watch out for the camera.
I just broke all the rules.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm out.
Must be important to her. Let's suppress her now.
Yeah. No, I just recollect when we were designing this outline that partly what we're also speaking about is even if you have a painful life experience where there's a major, something that we would call, something someone called earlier, a freak accident or a major event that affects everyone in a family unit or
that
a group,
seems to be traumatic.
It seems to be painful. It seems to be emotionally difficult. If we embrace God's laws, we see that there's, and the principles involved, we see that there's a lot of learning and growth that can happen for everyone involved. Mm. And so it's not wasted ever. And little things that seem to affect just one person, it actually has many flow-on effects for everyone involved. And so this law of attraction, even if we consider that, it's bringing us events that not just affect you, but if we're all sensitive, it's there for everyone around you as well to learn and grow from. So this is partly what we were thinking about in terms of economy as well.
Yep. Okay. Thanks, mate.
Thank you.
Okay. Time, 16:02. Got 3 minutes. Should I let one more question go? Yes, I will, I think. Maybe if we go to Nat. Natalie? You had two questions, actually, and I'll try to answer both of them in the time I've got. Can you ask your first one?
Yeah, I made it more succinct. Do you want to read the first part?
What
do
you want to make? Can you explain what you mean by the law shall be
incorporated within the creation itself?
Yep.
I was confused because, like, the example being, I know I don't always use my time efficiently. I don't use matter necessarily efficiently.
Yep.
And if economy is incorporated within me as a creation.
No. See, it's not incorporated within you. It's incorporated within the principles and the laws that govern you. And you can break them.
Right.
You can break them.
Yeah.
Because you are a
free-thinking,
free-feeling being.
Yeah.
You can break them, okay. Whereas an animal can't. They'll do the most economic thing, except if you influence them. But you can. You can break them.
Okay.
Because you've got free will.
Yeah.
Mm.
Okay.
Yep. So it's very important that we see that free will has a large effect on our lives, and actually a lot. See, basically what you're saying is, oh, but I don't use my time and energy and matter just right. I know that. Isn't that God's fault? It's really what you're saying, right? And I'm saying, no, it's not God's fault. God's created a whole universe where everything, time, energy, matter, everything is all utilized perfectly, economically. And you have decided to not do that. And then when you get the penalty of that, which is that you can't create everything you wanted to create, that you can't do everything you wanted to do and so forth, you say, isn't that God's fault? Just like we say often, isn't it God's fault for everything that we've done? And this is where we attribute to God our own creations, right? And we'll talk about that a bit with when we talk about authority, because we're frequently attributing to God what are actually our own creations.
Is it just emotions then that like prevent us from seeing these resources equally?
Obviously, a person who... It's not only emotions, it's also learning, obviously. Because part of learning is to learn that that we have resources available to us. Now, why don't we learn those things? Well, because the average person on the planet doesn't learn those things, and so they don't teach it, and this is a problem, you know. And that problem certainly is because we have certain emotions that prevent us from teaching our children these basic principles. You imagine if you taught a 2-year-old some of these principles, by the time they're 5 or 6, they'll be living in their own house, eating their own food, looking after their own environment in the most economical and easy way. You won't have to care for them anymore because God's caring for them and it's God's child anyway. And do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But see, we want to own the child. We want to direct the child. We want to boss the child. We want the child to satisfy our own sense of well-being and our own sense of worth and so forth. We want all these things from a child. So we've got to own them to have all that. So we own them. We possess them. We try to control them and dictate to them what they do. So they never leave home until they're 20. And in the case of some other people, like my brother, he's still at home and he's 40. Right?
Yeah.
And the reason why is because he's getting everything he wants on tap. He's getting all of his addiction on tap. There's no need to leave home, is there? There's no need to be self-sufficient. But they also don't ever experience the joy of that life, them either. The joy of that knowledge. So, yeah, we've got to remember when you're judging the current human condition, you are judging it already from a perspective that is already distorted by the fact that we're disobeying the majority of God's laws and principles and receiving the consequences of that disobedience for many millennia.
Okay.
And so we've got to be very careful how we analyse these things sometimes, yeah, because actually many of the things you're saying, but aren't we having this problem? Aren't we having that problem? I'm saying, but who created that problem? It wasn't God.
No,
it was you. Humans. It was us, humans.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks.
That's good. Okay. I've got to move on to the function principles. Now we come to Patty. So this is now function principles. So I'll just quickly skip over to function principles. There we go. That's the subject that we're on. And Patty had a question about the basic thing about function. Yeah.
Does God consider art to have function?
Well, it depends what kind of art you're talking about. Human art, no, not very much function at all. The reality is human art is very much just one thing, isn't it? Left in a gallery of thing. It may inspire some emotions, so it's having multiple functions. It inspires different emotions in different people, so that's a function from God's perspective. And it might be beautiful to look at, but that's debatable in many cases. it's unique, and quite frequently human art is all about impression and emotion and actually damaged emotions frequently. But God does create art. You just go outside and have a look at the environment. Everything's artistic. A butterfly, artistic, has function. Mm-hmm. A grub that turns into a butterfly, artistic, has function. What doesn't? You look at a fly. Some amazing things that you see in a fly all have function, artistic. Like all of God's art is generally living, or a combination of living and matter that's being transformed to life. Not like us, most of our art is dead. Mm-hmm. Right? Has to be preserved. You know, the insects want to eat it. That should tell you something about how God thinks about it. Does that make sense? It does. It literally tell you how God thinks about it. He's going, You think that's a beautiful picture? It's only some life for some insects to destroy from his perspective. So that doesn't mean that we should suppress our artistic desires. What it means is that we should start looking at how to incorporate our artistic desires into things that actually have function. So I feel like a vehicle manufacturer does that. You know, they try to make the design nice and pleasing to look at and so forth while it still has function. So that's an indication of somebody who's thought more about their art. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
You know, a person who designs a nice looking mobile phone even has given more consideration to function than the average artist has. Okay. So in a way, they're more artistic than the artist, mm-hmm. you see?
Mm-hmm.
And why are artists honoured? Well, for most people, art becomes a very selfish pursuit as well, doesn't it? It's about, you know, making yourself think, oh, I did that art and I won the full time thing, rather than it being something that has multiple functional purposes to invoke emotion and also that actually does something, that has some functions that benefit humanity in other ways. Do you see?
Okay.
Now, God does that with art. But most people who are involved in art don't do that. They're very self-absorbed in the way that they're doing their art. And they have higher emotional demands generally of wanting people to honour their art without the fact that there's no function in it. Does that trigger all of your artists out there? And it's just, but it is interesting, isn't it, how, you know, like, how we create art is very self-absorbed in a lot of ways. We're not thinking about function. We're not thinking about what emotions it might invoke. We're not thinking about the beauty of something. And quite often, men often do the opposite. They create something that's very functional but has no beauty at all. You know what I mean? So we have injuries in both respects. God doesn't. Everything God creates is purposefully beautiful but also purposefully has a large variety of functions built into it. And that requires serious thought, does it not? It requires some serious consideration. And this is where most of us, see, when we get involved in an addiction, what we do? We're so involved in satisfying the addiction that we don't think any further than the addiction itself. So what we do is we go out, let's say the addiction might be, I want people to honour the fact that I've got this artistic skill, so I draw a picture, hang it up, and everyone goes, ah, ooh, ah. And there's no function to it other than just go ah, ooh, and ah for a few moments and then you're off in your life, aren't you, generally? It barely invokes, for most of them, barely invokes even any emotion. But that's not what God does. What God does is he creates everything that has beauty that's also got function. And everything that has function also generally has beauty. And when I say generally, like it's without exception that I've observed, and even the most, like what you, like a cockroach, most of you probably think is not very beautiful. But at the end of the day, you go and have a look at them and have a look at the function, look at what they do, and you'll start seeing them in a different light, right? You'll start seeing them as a very beautiful creation. And insects that bite us, we think are not beautiful. But the reality is, if you examine them carefully, you see the beauty in every creation that's intrinsically involved in the creation, while at the same time, that creation has a functional purpose. And usually not just one. When I say usually, I've never seen a creation that does not have more than one functional purpose. So this is what God does. So now let's look at art again as the question. What do you reckon the answer is? It's pretty obvious, isn't it, Patty?
Yeah.
The answer is obviously, yeah, a lot of times we're creating art just for selfish reasons so that we get the accolade, the immediate accolade that we're looking for without any conscious thought of the use of resources and time to create function as well as beauty. So what we're doing with art is we're using resources, we're using time and energy, our energy and even other people's energy by, you know, looking at it. We're using energy, time and resources to create one thing, what we believe is beautiful, and often that's just in the eye of the beholder. And we're not creating any functional purpose other than that. Now, isn't that quite a selfish thing to do? So you've got to question how much art is really driven by selfish addictions under those circumstances. Now, God's art is not driven by selfish addiction. God's art benefits creation, benefits all creation, benefits us. We look at it, we think it's beautiful, but it also has functional purposes. It's amazing how God has integrated these two things, function and economy, to create some beautiful creations that have major benefits to our life as humans, but also to life on the planet. Yeah. And if we were truly interested in art, that's what we would do. And this is where I feel quite strongly that people like who are designing cars, for example, are frequently more artists than people who just draw pictures, because they at least have a function in their art. Many artists produce things and there's no function at all. A potter, at least there's some role there that is, you can utilize something. There's a bit of function in art, but for the majority, there's very little function in art nowadays. Yeah. Just creating art for art's sake is not something God does. So if we do it, we've got to question our motivation. And usually it's addiction. Now I'm going to get thousands of art letters from artists all over the world. What are you saying to us? There's quite a few people who have asked that question, so that's why I spent a bit of time on it. There's quite a number of you who asked it. Someone, it looks like function, there's not that many questions. Three questions and all of them are about art. Fair enough. Can you see your concern, obviously, if you're asking that question? Yeah, in my mind, there are many people on this planet who are quite artistic, but we don't recognize them as artists because they're creating things for functional purposes that are also quite lovely to look at and so forth. And we don't recognize them as such because we focus more on the functional purpose than the fact that they've done something that's quite beautiful to look at. Yeah, it's interesting how God does things in comparison to humans. I've got my thing out. I'll just do that. So are there any more questions about function? Yeah, Louise, you want to ask?
I was just wondering if singing and songs and writing is, because it does have a function but and can be beautiful, is that obey the function principles or not?
Well, again, you're asking questions that are subjective in nature, and I'm going to just answer it subjectively. But the way music is used in the spirit world, it's a good example of that in the Robert James Lee's material with the magnetic chorale, right? So it's a combination of function with other things. It's not ever just for its own sake sort of thing. Or in particular nowadays, I notice with a lot of music, it's for the sake of the performer to get adulation, which is not a proper functional purpose or a loving functional purpose from God's perspective. So when I see performers performing music only for the sake of their own adulation, it just turns me off straight away as a result. But you'll find as you connect more and more to God's love and truth-based principles, you'll see the difference between someone who's actually using their art, whatever that art be, in music or art or other, for functional purposes, in comparison to somebody who's just using it for selfish purposes. Yeah, it's rare on the planet to see, it's not unknown, but it's rare on the planet to see people using it for functional purposes. But it's not unknown. There are people who are doing it. Yeah, combination of those things, which is great, right?
Yeah. Thank you.
If we come down to Ivana. Keep your hand up, Ivana, so Chris knows where you are. Thanks.
I was just wondering what the penalty on the soul is if you are creating something that doesn't have a function. Like, does it depend on, the resources that you're using to create that? And how it might harm other people or the resources that might not be left in the future?
Correct.
Yep.
So the way God examines things with every one of these principles is there is an effect, a long-term effect, short-term effects. There are effects on people's soul. There's the effect on other people and what happens to other people's life as a result of your choices to do things out of harmony with God's principles. And as a result, the compensatory effects of your actions will be based upon how much of that has actually happened and how it's affected other people.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, it makes sense, doesn't it, when you think about it? Because you could actually use huge amounts of resources just for selfish purposes, can't you? Yeah, if we go straight behind you to Dave.
Thanks. If the law is automated, requiring no external maintenance, how is God able to achieve such a high level of consistency?
Well, that's a testament to God's level of automation. It's a bit like you've programmed, right? You program, yeah. So you know what programming is like. When you program some code in a computer, you're actually basically making laws. Can you see that?
Yeah.
So you can see the more intricate programming code that you create, the more intricate the possible outcome of what that law-based system will create. Right? Now, with computers, it's mostly just zeros and ones, but the reality is there's robots and everything that can be controlled by them. There's a whole heap of creations that can result from zeros and ones being put in the right order under the right code and with the right laws. If you can think about God basically doing the same thing to an intricate, infinitely intricate degree, then you have some concept about what God is able to create with law. Yeah. And really, that's what the laws are. They're like programming code. Now, some of the programming code is inbuilt in the device, you could call it. But let's look at the human body, the programming code, the DNA structure, the deoxyribonucleic acid, put together in such a way as to create a strand that defines every aspect of the human genetic structure, that allows then this replication process to occur. Now that's like programming code that a person may program, exactly the same thing, but it's built into the creature, allowing that creature to governs itself through that code. Then there's external laws that are imposed upon the creature, and they are a mixture of other things, so these principles will start going through tomorrow when we start talking about scope, how the individual laws are created and how the amalgamation of lower, what you call lower life forms, I suppose you call it, or lower matter and lower laws, and amalgamated together create new laws and higher complex beings. And each one of those things usually have built-in properties and external properties that relate to those built-in properties. So, for example, we've given an example today about hydrogen and oxygen having an attraction, right? Due to the way the atomic structure has been created, they have an attraction, which creates water. And they desire to create water when they're together, right? And this is an example of a built-in property. And the same applies right the way through to the human soul. The human soul has a huge amount of built-in properties, millions of them, that allow the human soul to function. So the question really is about how intricately God has programmed everything.
Yeah.
Really. And when you program a computer, you get some sort of understanding of that to a degree, because you have to use the building blocks of a program to create function. But God does that too. This immense, infinite degree, obviously, because of God being infinite himself. Yeah.
Thanks.
Amazing, eh?
Yeah.
Just incredible. If we go to Felix, and that's probably going to have to be our last question, Felix.
Does the function principle mean that if humans design artificial intelligence or robotics, how would that govern doing that in a loving way? And would there be a danger of, for example, using AI or robotics to, you know, take away too much employment from people and things like that, which has like been a concern of humans for a long time?
But see, again, you're asking a question that supposes or presupposes a number of things. Firstly, yeah. Employment on Earth is supposing that we need to be employed in order to earn money. And money on Earth is again supposing a number of things too. The reality is we don't really need money. If we were living in a loving environment, each of us would have enough food, enough clothes, enough shelter, the basic necessities of life that we wouldn't have to necessarily work for, but we would all want to work because we take responsibility for our own lives. And so money would become unnecessary, therefore the work unnecessary, therefore doing things like a robotic thing may actually be advisable so that we have less. Like a lot of the functions are looked after. But the way God's created robotics is very different to that, of course. God's robotics are all about living creatures. Whereas we don't understand how to invoke life in our current state. We don't understand how to invoke life into something we create and therefore make it living. You understand?
So are you saying that if somebody creates like a robot or some kind of something like that, that can always have a loving purpose? No,
I'm saying that if we could create one that's alive.
Could we even do that?
Of course. It's done many times in the spirit world, so yes, of course. We can, but we have to invoke God to provide the life principle, the life force to that creation. And this is where most of the scientists of the planet have no connection with God and therefore unable to do that. And so what we end up doing is creating mechanical devices that are driven by energetic systems, you know, electricity, magnetics and so forth, that enable automation. But the reality is we could go much further than that if we truly understood how life gets transmitted and so forth, and how we can actually ask God to make things come alive for us and things like that. So the future potential for us on the even on Earth is that we could create genetic structures that then we ask God to infuse with life, and if it's done in harmony with all of God's principles, God will do such a thing, and then that thing becomes alive, and it might have multiple functions and beauty as well, and it assists our life in some way, just like a robot would in our current concept, but it'd actually be alive.
Okay. But can I ask one more question about that, or are you out of time?
No, I'm out of time.
Okay.
Yeah.
No worries. Thanks. Yeah. Thank you very much. Yeah.
No worries, guys. So that's our day for today. You find that interesting?
Yes.
Yep. That's good. That's good. Thank you. And so now we've covered six of the principles, six of the foundation principles. We have two more foundation principles to cover. And then we'll move on to the order-based principles, and we'll talk about those in the next session. So hopefully you're starting to see the scope of things, right? In terms of how it relates to everything in your life, really, doesn't it? Everything in your life this relates to. And it's a very fascinating field of investigation and discovery. And so what I'd like to encourage you to do tonight and in the morning is have a look at your next set of outlines for tomorrow and have a good examination of those and bring along your questions like you've done today so that we can have a nice positive discussion about those principles tomorrow. That'd be fantastic. And Mary, you want to just say before we go?
I just wanted to thank everyone for using the new question system.
Yeah.
It was really great, really awesome questions. So thank you, everyone.
Yeah, so we got to not waste time. So that was fantastic. And sorry for those of you who I skipped over because we've ran out of time, but you know, we hope to answer some of your questions, because there were some questions even in that session I would have liked to answer. Yours, Gabby, I would have liked to answer. But we'll have to put it into our Q&A sessions and do it that way. Does it make
sense?
The
benefit is we've got those questions now already, which is so great.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Yeah. So thanks for your time, guys. We'll see you in the morning. 11 o'clock tomorrow is our start.